So today our lecture is on road related infrastructure, but really I am going to cover both roads and the railways in my lecture, especially entire land transport. So my name is Miha Somavira. I'm former secretary to the Ministry of Transport and Civil Aviation. I retired from the government service in 2017. Actually, I started my I graduated from the University of Moratuwa in 1981. In the same year, I joined Department of Buildings as a junior engineer. Since then, I was continuously working for the government under various departments, and then came to ministry. I joined the ministry as the director programming, and then came up to the position of the secretary in 2005. And I worked for different ministries, and I have been secretary to the Ministry of Transport twice, from 2006 to 2008, and again from 2015 to 2017. So I prepared my lecture notes based on my experience, especially in the engineering field as well as the general administration. So you know the term that three letters, meaning of three letters, ESG. When you get the full professional qualification in engineering, you can use ESG in front of your name. So I have another four letters, PLNR. That is for a professional planner. Actually, I got my master's qualification in town and county planning, and I became a professional town planner, and that is what I use, that PLNR. Now, you know, after passing out from the university, you have to select your field, whether you go to academic field or the industry. So if you go to academic field, either you work for a university or a technical college as a lecturer or maybe instructor. And if you come to the industry, either you may join the government or semi-government organization like corporation and boards, and the private sector. You may have your own firm, so in that case you will be an employer, or you can work under an employer in the private sector. So now you have to have some understanding about how the government works. Although you run your own business, you must have some general understanding about the governance. So when you take the government structure and the responsibilities, in Sri Lanka, now we have three-tier government structure. You have the central government at the top level, and the provincial councils at the middle level, and the local government. So in the central government, you get the various ministries, and maybe a minister in charge of that ministry, and there will be a secretary in charge of the administration of the ministry, and there will be several departments under that ministry, and there will be boards and corporations, state corporations, that is, those are called semi-government organizations under the ministry. And in 1987, we had the amendment to the Constitution of Sri Lanka, and that is called 13th Amendment. So that amendment introduced a new intermediate layer called the Provincial Councils. So we have 9 Provincial Councils, so 1 Provincial Council per each province. So we have 9 provinces and 9 provincial councils. Now, although the provincial council elections were not held, still the at their administrative structure is there. Chief secretary is there, governor is there, and all of the officials are functioning. But only thing, we don't have the elected members for the provincial council. And local government in our country, we have three types of local governments, local bodies, municipal councils like Colombo, and major towns you have municipal councils, and urban councils for the next level of cities, and the Pradeshiya Sabhas for the rural areas. So I think you have to have some fair knowledge about the constitution. So these days we are talking about the 20th amendment, no? So today they brought that bill, proposal to the parliament, and they are going to amend the constitution again, replacing the 19th amendment. They are going to bring another amendment to the constitution, and they say they are going back to the 18th amendment. So now in Sri Lankan history, after independence, the major restructuring happened in, of course, in 1977, we opened up our economy, and with that, in 1978, then the government brought in a new constitution for the country. And after that, there were several amendments to the constitution. So the 13th amendment is very, very important. So you have to have a fair knowledge about the 13th amendment. So it divided power among the central government and the provincial councils. So before that, we had only central government. Every powers were with the central government, except the that grassroots level local authorities. So 13th amendment specified the duties for central government and the provincial council. So our subject matter, the transport, is falling within both lists, the central government list as well as the provincial council list. So therefore the subject of transport, central government also having some powers, and the provincial council also having some powers. So in the 13th amendment, there are two lists. So you can study the 13th amendment to the constitution, so you can find these two lists. One is provincial council list, other one is called reserve list. That is, reserve list is for the list of functions for the central government. So the transport sector functions for the central government. So according to that reserved list, the central government list of the 13th amendment, the following subjects and functions with the central government: all ports and harbors are governed by the central government. When you take Colombo Port, Gol Port, Trincomalee Port, Oluwil, even KKS, those are all under the central government. Provincial council has no power or functions related to port and harbors. Aviation and airports, all international airports, we have two international airports, Katunayake, Bandaranaike International Airport, and Mattala International Airport. Also Colombo Airport, also earlier at Ratmalana, also had the international status. And there are regional airports, like smaller airports used for domestic aviation. And thing called national transport. National transport includes railways, all railways, highways declared by law made by the parliament. So what is the law made by the parliament? Earlier it was called Thoroughfare Ordinance. I think laws made during the British colonial rule is called ordinances. So the thoroughfare ordinance was enacted during that time. So later they passed Road Development Authority Act. So the thoroughfare ordinance is replaced by the Road Development Authority Act. So the highways declared under the Road Development Authority Act are governed by the central government. Then all carriages of passengers and goods by railway, land, sea or air, by mechanically propelled vessels are coming under the central government. So that includes all ferries, boat services, and those are all coming under the central government. So then we go to the transport sector agencies under the central government. So there is Ministry of Transport. It's called Ministry of Transport Services now. So these are the agencies coming under the Ministry of Transport, Railway Department. So they have the monopoly of operating railways in our country, because no other organization can operate railways other than the Railway Department. And the Sri Lanka Transport Board. So they operate some of the state-owned buses. They operate state-owned buses, and the Department of Motor Traffic. So that is a regulatory organization controlling motor traffic, especially all traffic rules are formulated by the Department of Motor Traffic. Even the issuing of driving licenses and registering of motor vehicles are done by the Department of Motor Traffic. It's a very important department, and it brings a lot of revenue to the government. And National Transport Commission. So why National Transport Commission? So there are privately owned buses. So there should be a regulator to control and maintain the, quality of bus service. So for that, actually, we have National Transport Commission. But National Transport Commission can regulate only interprovincial bus services, long distance bus services, not the buses operating within the province. Then the National Transport Medical Institute, so they are the supporting organization for the Department of Motor Traffic. And there is a small organization called Road Safety Council. So they look after the safety aspect of motor traffic and the roads. And the Lakdiw Engineering is a small organization under the Sri Lanka Transport Board, a subsidiary organization for the repair of buses. And there is another important ministry, Ministry of Road Development. So the main organization under Ministry of Road Development is the Road Development Authority. So they are in charge of development and maintenance of the national road network in our country. So other ministry is the Ministry of Port and Shipping. So main organization under that ministry is the Sri Lanka Port Authority. So they are in charge of development and the maintenance of ports in our country. And although the Ministry of Urban Development and Housing, their functions are not directly related to transport, they are in charge of urban planning and land use planning in our country. So the main organization in charge of urban planning is the UDA, Urban Development Authority. although they are not directly related, there is lot of impact on the transport, on land use. So therefore, Ministry of Urban Development and Housing also very important organization, and especially UDA. And earlier we had the megapolis project. So the new government is going to, I think, abolish that project. And SLRDC is the Sri Lanka Low-Lying Area Reclamation Board. So they are in charge of development of urban land, especially land reclamation, and they are creating necessary land for urban development. So then we will go into the national urban transport policies and plans. So in 2014, then Ministry of Transport and Civil Aviation, with the technical assistance of JICA, Japan International Cooperation Agency, we completed a master plan for urban transport system development for Colombo. Colombo Metropolitan Region in 2014. So under the same technical assistance, a feasibility study also carried out for the implementation of monorail system for Colombo. So that JICA master plan identified the present transport problems within the Colombo Metropolitan Region, and they proposed certain solutions. So they are one of the recommendation is to have a mass transit system for Colombo. So that is what they carried out, a feasibility study for monorail system. And also a study was undertaken for the implementation of bus rapid transit system for some selected transport corridors in Colombo by University of Moratuwa. So under that they carried out a feasibility study for Gold Road corridor. And then during the previous government, under the Megapolis Ministry, they prepared a Megapolis transport plan. That is also based on the same transport master plan prepared by JICA, and they updated that plan, and also they consider Colombo Megapolis master plan prepared for the urban development in making their final recommendations in the Megapolis transport plan. Then again, Ministry of Transport also has developed a transport policy. So when you go to their website, you can find the draft transport policy. So that is also a very useful document. And also, with the assistance of the Asian Development Bank, in 2017, they started a master plan for the railway sector. So that is under preparation. That is also with the ADB assistance. So then the master plan for urban transport system development, they consider in their master plan, the socio-economic conditions and the urban structure within the Colombo Metropolitan Region, and also present transport problems and the planning issues. And also now the Colombo metropolitan area, they define an area called Colombo metropolitan area. So that is almost covering the entire western province. Based on the population density, so they consider that as a one unique planning area for their planning exercise. So in their master plan, so they had an implementation plan and the institutional arrangement to implement their recommendations. Then came the megapolis transport plan. So under the previous government, the Ministry of Megapolis and Western Development, they also used the same two comprehensive studies to develop Western Region Transport Plan with the collaboration of all transport sector agencies, because at that time also there was a Ministry of Transport and Ministry of Megapolis was the planning organization. So even Urban Development Authority also under them, and they had a committee called Three Secretaries Committee. So there was Ministry of Secretary to the Ministry of Megapolis, Secretary to the Ministry of Transport, and Secretary to the Ministry of Highways. They were working in a committee to have a better coordinated plan. So they are in the Megapolis Transport Plan. They have identified some priority projects for implementation under the Western Region Transport Plan. So they propose some short-term measures like introduction of flexible staggering working hours for government organization as well as the private sector. They have different working hours to ease the congestion on city roads during the peak hours. And also certain recommendations for the parking management within the city. And certain intersections were selected for improvement and also improvement in signaling. And also they propose some they wanted to bring some regulations to control school and office transport services. So when you in our city roads, you can see lot of school services and also office transport services. So they want to bring in some regulations to control those office buses as well as the school buses. And also there were some proposals for restructuring public bus service, especially the management of buses, also certain quality improvement in public buses. So they want to bring in some regulations. And also they recommend to carry out the feasibility on bus rapid transit. As a start, they wanted to start the bus priority lane. So that is under implementation now. Actually, the last government, they started it on a pilot basis. And now, I think from last week, they are practicing it in some of the selected routes in the city of Colombo, aiming at managing the city traffic during the peak hours. Then they also propose multimodal transport hub. So what is multimodal transport hub? You can see a similar kind of multimodal hub in Kottava now. So similar multimodal hubs they are proposing at Feta and some places like Borella. And also they recommend railway electrification and modernization. So that will improve the quality of the present railway service and road improvements and the road capacity improvement. That of course they are referring to the expressway network as well as some of the feeder roads feeding the by roads in Colombo. But you know, within the city of Colombo, there is no space for road capacity improvement now, other than a small widening, like maybe 2 to 3 feet, like, but you can't add a separate lane because there is no space available. So the draft transport policy developed by the Ministry of Transport, you can go to the website to see the detail. I'm just highlighting here their major focus areas, the background to the policy, and the policy principles, policy goals, policy directives, and improvement for implementation also there, and implementation arrangement. So this draft policy was published in February 2018. You can see that draft policy in the website of the Ministry of Transport, Ministry of Transport Services. And then the Railway Master Plan. So as I said earlier, the Railway Department, they started the formulation of Railway Master Plan with the assistance of the Asian Development Bank consultant, and they first did the traffic demand analysis, and they also reviewed the present railway infrastructure like station facilities, railway tracks, and the land belongs to railway, and they also studied the present railway operation. And then they are going to develop commercial and financial strategy for the railway. Unfortunately, at the moment, they don't have a commercial and financial strategy for the railway department. And also, they are going to propose some institutional development within the railway to suit the present day requirement. And also, land asset management, that is a very important function. Your railway department is the biggest landowner in our country. They have 14,000 acres of land belong to railway department that unfortunately they don't have a proper record about the land utilization. And also even the income generated by leasing those lands, surplus land, is very, very small compared to the acreage they are having. So they are generating approximately around 100 million rupees a year. So that is not sufficient, because in other countries, the railway organization, they generate 30% of their income from the real estate or the land asset belongs to those railway organizations. So they are going to develop detailed report on how they should manage their valuable land asset. And also, they are going to develop all-way railway sector development framework. So the, I think, final report of the master plan yet to publish. At the moment, they are past halfway and they have done lot of work. And then I go to the objective of the transport master plan. So the main objective of the transport master plan is to prepare a reliable transport database to evaluate and formulate future transport development plans. So when you have a transport master plan, you can evaluate individual projects. So when you have a master plan, you can evaluate individual projects using the database in the master plan, and also formulate comprehensive master plan with justification of selected priority leading projects. So that is another objective, to formulate a comprehensive master plan with justification of selected priority or lead projects. So in the master plan, we have a list of projects with some justification for the priority. So then everyone can understand why this project is priority. And also under the master plan, you can conduct the feasibility study on prioritized projects. So these are the main objectives of the transport master plan. So when you look into the present status of the national transport system, so we have, you know what is motorized transport. All engine driven type of transport is called motorized transport. So there are two types, motorized transport and non-motorized. Non-motorized means the bicycles and walking and that type of thing is non-motorized, and all other modes are motorized transport. So we have around 80 billion passenger kilometers annually, the motorized transport, the size of the motorized transport. So main transport modes are bus transport and rail transport, and in addition we have three wheelers and private taxis, cars, vans, etc. on our roads. And the passenger transport, road based passenger transports, are mainly undertaken by the public and the private buses. So today 61% of the passenger transport is done by the buses. So bus transport share is 61%, and for that we have approximately around 30,000 buses. So there are about 24,000 privately owned buses, and the government owned buses around 6,000. So those are the buses owned by the Sri Lanka Transport Board. Although they have 6,000 buses in total, the buses which are on running condition may be around less than 5,000 today. And the railway share in the passenger transport is just 5%. Although the railway, the national average is 5%, railway has a major role in the commuter transport within the Western province, especially during the peak hours. So when you take railway during the peak hour, the commuter transport during the peak hours, the railway share is just above 13%. So that is what, when there is a railway strike, we find it very difficult to manage with the buses. When you take corridors, now when you take Colombo city, we have 7 corridors carrying passengers to Colombo city. Out of those 7 corridors, 4 corridors are covered by railway. Those are the main line, that is that Kandy Colombo corridor, and the Nigambu line or Putlam line, coastal line going up to Mathura and now Beliyatta, and the Kalani Valley line. Those are the four railway corridors. And when you take those corridors, except Kalani Valley, all other three corridors, the railway share is nearly 40% of the public transport of that particular corridor. So when you take Colombo Kandy corridor during the peak hour, railway share within the corridor, trips made within the corridor, out of that total trips, 40% is by the railway. So that is what the railway is very, very important to actually giving very valuable service during the peak hour. So that is what there is the government as well as the donor ADB think it is very, very justifiable to invest in the railway. So that is, railway means 100% public transport. So if you invest in roads, you are promoting more than the public transport, you are promoting private modes. When you widen the roads, there will be more and more private vehicles are coming and they are enjoying the roads. So we are not, in other words, we are not promoting public transport. We are promoting transport but not public transport. So benefit to the public is more when you invest in rail rather than the roads. So when you take the good transport, the freight transport, 98% of the good transport present day happening in the happening by road. Only railway share is less than 2%. So this situation was changed during 1950s. Before 1950s, railway had a larger share, but due to import of more lorries and widening of the network, road network, roads become very popular, and people were changing from rail to road. And this is the existing road network in our country. At present, the roads are the backbone of the country, transport sector in our country, because 90% of the passengers and 98% of the freight are carried by roads. So that is what the government is giving priority for the road development. So road network of the country consists of about 116,000 kilometers. So those roads are divided into national, provincial and the rural and other roads in terms of the responsibility of maintenance of the roads. And now we are having new expressways also. So this is the entire network. So we have 12,000 kilometers, approximately 12,000 kilometers of national highways, and we have another around 16,000 provincial roads, and about 83,000 rural roads, and another 4,000 other roads. Other road means there are roads owned by the estates, upcountry, tea states, they have their own roads. And our road density is 1.76 kilometer per square kilometer. So when compared to South Asia, our road density is high, but when we compare with the developed countries, not satisfactory situation. So when you take the national highways, we can again divide the national highways into various categories. We have 161 kilometers of expressways. Now it is little more because this is before commissioning of the outer circular road between Kadavata and Vattala. So now with the addition of that mileage, it will be around 200 kilometers now. And RDA is having two classes of roads, class A roads and class B roads. So class A we have about 4,215, and the class B highways we have around 8,000. There are around 4,200 bridges on these national highways. So those are the important statistics in the road sector. So in the expressway network, we have Southern Expressway, 126 kilometers. This is up to Mathura, but now the road has been extended beyond Mathura. So you'll have to add that mileage. And Colombo-Katunayake Expressway, 25 kilometers. And Outer Circular Expressway, 29 only up to Kadavata. So you have to add the mileage beyond Kadavata. So now entire network is now operational. So now in the transport sector, there are two types of problems. Transport problem, there can be inter-regional transport issues. When you go from one region to another, say if you are traveling from Colombo to Anuradhapura, so if you don't have a good network of roads or rail, so we say the connectivity is low. So if there is a good network, we can say the connectivity is very good. So then the when you have expressways, the traffic from out stations, they come to the city very fast. But if you don't have a good network of roads within the city, you get another problem. So you get congestion. So you cannot have elevated roads in the city, because every junction you can't have connections. So the best solution is to promote public transport within the city. So then the railway network. So today we have 1450 kilometers of network, and there are 172 stations and 161 substations in the entire country. And except these 126 kilometers double track within the Colombo metropolitan region or the western province. Western province, we have double tracks, and outside western province, we have only single tracks. And even within western province, the Kalaniveli line is having single track. So the early days, the British, they developed railways not for passenger transport. They developed railways for the good transport, to bring their plantation produce to the harbour. They use railway. So that is what actually you have a good network covering entire hill country. And today the railway, we are using railway for the suburban passenger transport, commuter transport for long distance as well as the short distance transport within the Colombo metropolitan region. So then In 2016, we prepare a railway sector strategic investment program from 2016 to 2021. So under that, there were recommendations to improve the track, also the rolling stock. Rolling stock means the engines and the passenger compartments and the wagons for the food transport. So then I'll come to the ongoing and the planned major urban transport projects in our country. So earlier I mentioned that in 2016, with the help of the Asian Development Bank, we carried out a feasibility study for the railway sector, and there we identified both the short-term as well as the long-term recommendations for the improvement of the railway sector. This railway efficiency improvement project is one of the projects to improve the railway efficiency in the road short run. So today there are some problems in the railway sector. The railway communication system is very old one, and there were frequent breakdown in the communication system. There is no communication from railway driver to the railway guard or railway guard to the station master. So those are three important persons in the railway operation, where they have to have a very good understanding between those three to run a efficient railway service. So under this railway efficient improvement project, we are going to set up a new modern telecommunication system for the railway. So now I think procurement stage has passed, and now it is almost at the award stage, the modern telecommunication system tender. And another one is the railway ticketing system. I think it is one of the oldest tickets in the world, and there is only one company, I think, producing that ticket, and they are going to wind up their operation this year. So the railway department is having a big problem. So that is what we have included this smart ticketing and seat reservation system under this railway efficiency improvement project. And so we call worldwide tenders, and we are now, I think the contract has been selected, and that also at the award stage now. And very soon you will have a online ticket for the railway and online reservation system. You don't have to go and wait in the port railway station for the reservation of seats. At the moment there is some facility, I think, by Mobitel, but they are also covering a very small area. But we are going to have a good solution for the entire railway operation. And today they are losing 20% of the income due to ticketless traveling. So there won't be any ticketless traveling once you fully implement this one. So you will have that station also, all the facilities, I mean the vendor machines and everything will be provided, and you will have maybe a ticket online or paper ticket. So you will have various options. You don't have to go to the railway station to buy ticket. Sometimes nearby shop you can buy a railway ticket, or you can buy maybe online. And modernization of the railway workshop. So today's workshop at Ratmalana, one time biggest in the Asia. But today, although we have large acreage and large warehouses or the buildings, our machines are outdated now. So we are going to modernize all the machines there, so to suit the present day requirement, to either expedite the running repairs and the major repairs of the locomotives and the carriages. And new workshop, there will be a new workshop coming, and the track maintenance equipment. So I think the railway department is having nearly 20,000 labor force. Out of that 20,000, 7,000 is working under the Way and Works department for the rail track maintenance. But today, there is a shortage of 2,000 laborers. So nowadays, actually not like early days, the people cannot do hard work. So due to that, actually we are going to introduce a lot of machineries. Actually, we are going to semi-mechanize the rail track maintenance. So we are going to bring in track maintenance equipment to expedite the track maintenance. And also the railway staff, they are short of housing, and there will be 300 housing units are coming under this project. And also upgrading of the technical training center. So we have two training centers in Sri Lanka, German Technical Institute. You must have heard about the German Tech. So we know that German Tech doing the, I think, bus repairs. So they are very popular and they are very, I think, lot of demand. But unfortunately, the same thing, same institute developed for the railway has not developed. So we are going to develop the technical training center initiated by the German government for railways. So this railway efficiency improvement project is very important because so it will provide lot of support to railway, and it will improve the present railway operation. So that is short term. So we are going to implement all these projects within a short span of 2 to 3 years. So within next 3 years, sometimes you can see a lot of development. So under that project, there is another smaller projects like there is a big bottleneck between Port and Maradana during morning and evening peak hours. So the trains get lined up even beyond Hunupitiya during the morning, because we have only 4 tracks between Maradana and Port station. So under this project, there is a proposal to construct another 4 lines. And for that, we have to, I think, change lot of structures. You know, there is an elevated road at Maradana station. So we have to, I think, remove the present bridge, road bridge, and elevate it to facilitate more tracks. And also there is a bridge called School Lane Bridge towards Maligavata site. We have to widen that bridge and then make present four lines. We have to expand it to 8 lines, because other than the commercial operation, all technical movements, when the trains are coming to, when the trains terminate at port, they have to go back to the yard. So those movements are called technical movements. So for that also, they are using these 4 lines. So due to that, there is a lot of congestion during the peak hours. So with the development, addition of those 4 lines, I think we are going to ease that congestion. So with that, we can see very good railway operation. And they are going to prepare a railway operation plan also. I think most of the trains will not terminate at port or Maradana in future. So they will pass through Maradana and port, and they may go to maybe Mount Lavinia, Moratuwa on the coastal line. The train starting from up line, I mean from Veyangoda, Polgahavila, that area. And also trains starting from coastal line will go up to maybe Ragama or it will go up to Om Agama on the calendar line. I mean, with the system is fully developed. So then the long-term project is the Colombo Suburban Railway project. So under that, they initially carried out a pre-feasibility in 2016 by a French firm called Aegis Rail, and they submitted their report in 2017, and then there was another procurement to select the partner or the consultancy firm for detailed feasibility and the detailed design of the Colombo Suburban Railway network. And in 2017, we were able to mobilize a South Korean firm called Doha Engineering for detailed feasibility and detailed design of four railway corridors, four railway lines. So there are, I think, the main components of the Colombo Suburban Railway project is upgrading and electrification of Kalaniveli line, that is 64 kilometers up to Avissavella, and upgrading and electrification of main line up to Rambukkana, and upgrading and electrification of coastal line up to Kaludara, that is 43 kilometers, and upgrading and electrification of Puttam line up to Nigambu, 23 kilometers. So that include a link to airport from Sidhua station, Katnayaka station. So the detailed design consultant, they mobilized in 2017, and now they have completed detailed feasibility on the Kalaniveli line and also detailed design, and they developed detailed drawings, bill of quantities and bid documents for Kalaniveli line, and according to their plan they are going to implement in three stages, the stage one up to Kottava, and they propose elevated option. They consider various options and they propose elevated option up to Kottava, and beyond from Kottava to Padukka, it is at grade but double line. They recommend to make double line, and beyond Padukka, they recommend to upgrade the existing single line. And they are now detailed design is 100% completed and bid document is ready for tendering. And the main line also, they have completed all studies and they have done the feasibility, economic feasibility, and they have developed detailed drawings and bid documents. And coastal line, they are in the process of developing detailed designs, and also on the Puttam line. So the present status of Kalaniveli line, as I explained, they have completed feasibility, detailed designs and the bid documents, and the EIA, Environment Assessment report is done and submitted to CEA, and it is now open for the public comments. So until you get the approval from the CEA, you cannot start any work, I mean the construction work. So we had to wait till the EIA approval. And also at present the main issue is, now earlier I explained most of the railway corridors during the peak hour, railway share within the corridor is nearly 40%, but Kalaniveli line it is just 10%. So that is because actually we have a single line, so you cannot operate railways on either direction. So due to that, during the peak hour, we can operate maximum 3 trades. So there is a capacity issue. There is no sufficient capacity in the railway, so the people cannot come to the railway. Because you can see entire 3 trains during the peak hours are jam-packed. So due to that, there is a lot of potential to develop the railway there. And if you develop into double line, you can increase the capacity by 4 times. So that means you can run 12 trains during the peak hour. So if you have 12 trains, definitely we can carry, we can have 40% share in that corridor also. So there will be lot of, I think, relief to the high level road, and lot of, I think we can ease the congestion of the high level road if you develop Kalani Valley line. And their first option was how to develop Kalani Valley line at grade. Because when you elevate it, when you elevate the railway line, cost will be double. If you go underground, cost will be 3 times higher than at grade. So that is what they initially tried to, I think, develop it at grade. But unfortunately, the issue is to develop double line at grade, you need 14 meters. But at the moment, the railway corridor is certain places you have 12 meters, certain places 10 meters. So the problem is now there are railway properties on either side. So those properties are, there are squatter families, they are occupying the railway land without authority. So we can easily relocate those people. So they are willing to move out. Only thing, we'll have to provide a housing unit for each family. But the acquisition of the private land is impossible because they have developed high-rise buildings on both sides of the Kalani Valley. So if you go to acquire those land, there will be a lot of public protests. So those people will object, definitely. And also government will have to, I think, find lot of money to acquire those properties, because you will have to pay for the buildings, pay for the, I think, loss of their businesses and the land, in addition to land. So the acquisition cost is huge. So due to that, they prepare estimate for both options, and they found it elevating the railway track is more cost effective than going at grade. So that is what actually decision was made, to go elevated. So there is another advantage of elevating the railway track. Once you elevate it, you need only 12 meters. Because when you go at grade, because if you are moving at 100 or above 80 kilometers, you will have to have a buffer between the houses and the railway track. So you don't have to maintain that once you elevated the track. That is what in most of the developed countries, they have either elevated or underground in the city limits. Because you cannot, because the land is scarce in the city. So you have to manage the land. It is a scarce resource. So you have to manage the land. So that is what you have to keep the land for other purposes, like the urban development. So the value of the land is very, very valuable. So to economize the land utilization, so they decided to go elevated. And there are certain, discussion going on that why elevated. So because they decided to go for elevated, it is more cost effective, and from the environment side also there are benefits. In addition, there is another aspect. The first 20 kilometers of the KV line, I think up to the place called, yeah, Maharagama. Beyond Maharagama, there is a, I think, that newly developed multimodal center. There are 20 level crossings. All those level crossings are very busy during the peak time. So then, if you go at train, every place, you will have to build a flyover. Otherwise, you will have you cannot have a smooth railway operation without a flyover. Definitely at a railway crossing, you will have to have a grade separation. Otherwise, you will have to slow down the train at the level crossing. And same time, you will have to stop vehicles. So then, they compare the cost of building 20 flyovers. So that is also one of the reasons they justify why they recommend elevated option. So now there is an agreement between UDA and the Transport Ministry. So UDA has developed some of the housing schemes for relocations, and they have already started relocation. They are started relocation of the unauthorized families living along the Kalani Valley line. So with that, they are going to take over those land for future railway development. And also they directly construct, the railway directly construct 120 houses in Malapalle. So they are also, they are about to award the contract for the 120 houses in Malapalle to relocate people living around that area, around Kottava, because that area we don't have UDA housing schemes. So earlier there was a proposal to call bids by end of the 2020. Now it has been postponed to 2023 because the government find it difficult to borrow any new loans. At the moment, we have borrowed heavily, and even to service the present loans, we'll have to spend, I think, 80% of our GDP is required to pay back the loans. So now I think the government thinks by 2023, the situation will become a little bit okay with the repayment of existing loans. So difficult period is from 2022, in fact 2019 to 2023. So the government will be able to go for a major loan only after 2023. So there is a slight delay in I think signing of the loan agreement. So therefore, even tendering will happen somewhere in 2023 for the new line. Also, this rapid transit system under the Megapolis planning project, they also carried out another feasibility for a light rail system. So they did a detailed feasibility. So this is the network they propose. And there was a line from Malabe to Fort, and there's another line from Kadavata to Fort, and there'll be another network within the city. So they have, I think, developed this rapid transit system for Colombo. RTS means rapid transit system for Colombo. So initially there was a proposal for JICA to fund the line from Malabe to Colombo Fort. Now due to high cost of construction, the government wanted to convert it to BOT, build, operate and transfer mode. So they will be calling proposals in the near future for the these are priority RTS lines. So once the entire network is developed with the railway upgrading and with this RTS network, so there will be a good network of public transport for the city in addition to buses. So with the implementation of all these projects only, we will have a very smooth inner city transport situation. Because when you go to countries like not only the Western world, when you go to countries like Malaysia, Kuala Lumpur, and maybe Thailand, Bangkok, you can see this kind of network in operation. Even in India, now they are implementing in their mega cities like Delhi, Hyderabad, and even Bangladesh is planning, even Vietnam is planning. So why not Sri Lanka? So we have to keep our plans ready and make the necessary land reservations for these projects. At least in another 10-15 years' time, we will be able to implement. So otherwise, we will not have any space for the implementation of transport projects. There will be buildings all over. So that is what actually we have a transport master plan, and then we have to, I think, preserve those land for those projects for future development. We may not be able to implement the project immediately, but at least we will have the land reserved for project implementation in future. So that is how baseline road was developed. Baseline road corridor was gazetted in 1950s. So due to that, none of the properties on either side of the baseline road was not developed. So when the government start development of baseline road, we had to demolish all dilapidated buildings. We never paid compensation for buildings. We paid compensation only for the land. So that is what actually we have to have that kind of system to freeze the development along the transport corridors. Then someday we will be able to implement those projects. So this is the proposal for the multimodal hub development in Colombo Port. This is the conceptual design. I think under the Megapolis project, this was, I think, they have done the detailed designs and we have had several discussions. So those plans also ready. And the elevated port access road, this is under implementation. You can see that network is developing now. The Kalani Bridge, New Kalani Bridge, I think work almost 80 to 90% completed. And also they have developed part of the elevated port access road. And there is another extension from here, from Murugudowatta to Rajagiriya. So that is also proposed. So finally, it will get connected to Athurugiriya site. And this is the new Kalani Bridge. I think you can see the same shape is now. They have done the cables and some of the columns. On the, I think they have to construct the part on the highway side. And this is that Kottava Rajagiriya, sorry, the Rajagiriya Koswatha side. So this is the proposed elevated road starting from that Murugudowatta to Battaramulla side. So that is, I think, in my short presentation. So I think you have got some idea. the long-term master plans as well as the short-term projects we are going to implement for the development of Colombo City and to ease the traffic congestion on the city roads. I think due to the financial difficulties, we may not be able to implement some of those projects in the very near future, but we have to keep the plans ready and we have to reserve the land for those implementation of those projects, because someday we have to implement those projects. So otherwise our city of Colombo will not be very attractive and there won't be any investor coming to our country. When the capital city is congested, no one will come to that country, because actually you can, I think, get some impressions actually. Once you land in Colombo, we should be able to get a good impression on the foreigners. Then only actually we can develop the country. And also the expert, they have estimated that the present loss to the economy due to the traffic congestion is huge. It's around 300 billion rupees per day. So there is a huge amount where you spend a lot of your time on roads and also valuable foreign exchange, because the entire fuel is imported to Sri Lanka. So we have to save the foreign exchange as well as our working hours, idling hours on roads, if you are planning to develop the country. Okay, thank you very much.